Now, the Queen of Sheba and her only son, Menelik, which we know as the Kibra Negesh, is a very, very important, is a very important document. But first of all, let's first of all recognize that the kingdom of David was renewed in Ethiopia. But what is Ethiopia? So here we have the Webster's Dictionary, right? But let's first show you what we mean. This is the Webster's New World College Dictionary. Webster's New World College Dictionary. Get a copy of the Webster's New World College Dictionary. Why? We'll show you why. Okay, let's now look up Ethiopia, because to establish our claim to the truth and to prove it, we have to first of all go to the meanings, right? The meanings. Now, why we like the Webster's Dictionary, because when we look at meanings, for example, let's go to the meaning of etymology, which we have highlighted right here, right? Etymology, right? You see this right here? Etymology. Etymology. Notice it has the word, the pronunciation in parentheses, the part of speech, noun, the plural with G's or etymologies. Then it has right here the etymological bracket, open bracket, M-E. A medieval English and OFR, Old French. It says etymology. Now, it is derived from, you understand, derived from L, right? Latin. The L stands for Latin right there. And it says etymologia, derived from Greek, right? Etymologia derived from Greek. Right, so it shows you where the word comes out from. Some of the etymological brackets break it down a little bit better. Like right here, when you look up etymon, it says Greek, Latin from Greek, etymon. It says literal sense of the word, etymology. Etymos, you see that right there? Etymos means true, derived from Indo-European. And then it's breaking it down to actually its very root, right? So the etymology is the origin and development of a word, affix, a phrase, etc., tracing a word or other form back as far as possible in its own language and to its source in contemporary or earlier languages. In this dictionary, etymologies are given in double brackets preceding the senses to which they apply. Secondly, it says the branch of linguistics dealing with word origin and development. So what we're seeing right here is word origin and development. Now, Ethiopia, what is Ethiopia? We have to establish this now by let's going here. We did this in the audio and in a visual version before, but we were reading from it, and now we want people to see what we were reading. All right? Ethiop. Let's deal with Ethiop. Ethiop here. They say it's archaic in bracket. But they don't define it. They don't define it for us. So we're going to define it elsewhere as we've defined it in our videos. But here it says Ethiop. They just have archaic in bracket. Then full caps. It says Ethiopian. Also Ethiope, so forth and so on. Oh, now we have Ethiopia. Ethiopia. Secondly, it says it doesn't define it. There's no etymological brackets, but here's the connotative definition they give. They say the ancient kingdom possibly dating to the 10th century B.C. in northeast NE Africa on the Red Sea, corresponding to modern Sudan and northern Ethiopia, the country. Now, this is very important because they say that possibly. They know we have our evidence, we have our proof, but they don't want to give full credence to the claim. They want to still put a speculative doubt about the fact that it is dating to the 10th century, the 900s. This is exactly when this particular Solomon and the Queen of Sheba and her only son Menelik occurs, and we have this version here by E.A. Wallace Budge that we use as a reference source, because then when we go over here to the Bible, you understand, Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, you understand, we're going to learn some very interesting things, because many confuse the Queen of Sheba with, let's go back to the third chapter. When we go to the third chapter, this is where a lot of confusion has come in right here. Solomon makes alliance with Pharaoh and marries his daughter. It says, and Solomon made affinity with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and took Pharaoh's daughter. Pharaoh's daughter is not the Queen of Sheba. It's important for us to emphasize that, because there's a lot of false teachers out there and pastors and preachers who allege that Solomon, he worshipped idols, and he fell to witchcraft, and Pharaoh's daughter was the Queen of Sheba, and they lump all of this up. But as if you notice, this is chapter 3 of the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings, right? 1 Kings is chapter 3 that we have Solomon making affinity with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and taking Pharaoh's daughter and brought her into the city of David until he had made an end of building his own house and the house of the Lord, the house of Yahweh, and the wall of Jerusalem round about. All right, round about. And it says that only the people sacrificed in high places because there was no house built to the name. Notice that the Shem, as in Shemitic, the Shem, the Lord God of Shem, the name of Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh, of Yahweh, until those days. And it says right here, and Solomon loved Yahweh, or the Lord, walking in the statutes of David his father, only he sacrificed and burnt incense in high places. You see, because the high places was used for the counterfeit worship. It's like today, if we have some of our Rastafari and Ethiopian Hebrew functions in churches, the churches are like the high places. They were built for the false god, or the whitewashed, blonde hair, blue eyed, lipstick and rouge, effeminate Jesus. So this is the old religion. You understand, the old religion was going out. And the true religion, the old false degenerate motherhood and feministic and goddess religions was going out, and they worshipped in the high places. This is what a lot of people don't really recognize. So it says that this was good that he was doing, but the people had still worshipped in the high places, which were devoted to the false gods. You understand? Namely, the goddesses were devoted to the false goddesses. You understand? So it gives us that right there, right? Now, if we go a little bit further, right, we find that Solomon was building his house 13 years. You understand? We'll talk about the Ark of the Covenant being brought in. And then we have in chapter 10, we have the Queen of Sheba. The Queen of Sheba. So chapter 10 of 1 Kings chapter 10, we have Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, and also 2 Chronicles 9:1-12. This was written later. 2 Chronicles 9:1-12 was written after the so-called captivity. This right here was written before. Now, what we have here in the Queen of Sheba and only son Menelik, you understand, as translated from the Ethiopic by E.A. Wallace Budge, is a testimony to the parts of the story that is not contained here in the Bible. You understand, this is history. These are histories. And even the Bible talks about other books that are not contained in the Bible. They say, if you want more about this, well, then go to these other books. Now, if you go to chapter 11, right, and chapter 11 is known as bankruptcy today. You understand? Here we can see King Solomon's bankruptcy. right? It says Solomon's heart turned away from Yahweh. But King Solomon loved many strange women. Right? It's not going to mention the Queen of Sheba anywhere here, because this takes place after what we have one chapter before. Let's just go back here. This is rightly dividing the word of truth, people. It says, chapter 10, Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. Let's read a little bit here. It says, and when the Queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the what? You see that? The name of the Lord, not the high places, not the idolatry, not the goddess cults, but the name of Yahweh, the name of Jah, if you please, but the name of Yahweh. She came to prove him with hard questions. You understand? She was seeking wisdom. Now, this book now will give you the details of the transaction. You understand, that were preserved in the Ethiopic accounting and documentation. You understand? But over here in the Bible, we have the fact that the Queen of Sheba, she came concerning the name of the Lord, the Shem of Yahweh. And she came to prove him with hard questions. She had hard questions she wanted to ask and really find out, because she was seeking wisdom. Because what most people don't recognize is that the Queen of Sheba, she was, in a sense, for lack of a better word, she was the head of, you could say, the feminist movement or the goddess cult, in that sense, in her time. You understand? In other words, she was a female ruler who was surrounded by the strange woman, the goddess cult, so forth and so on. But she was seeking, she sought wisdom, she was seeking the true God. The Queen of Sheba deserves to be honored, but many of these pastors, preachers, and other religious folks out there and silly, careless, so-called black Hebrews or Israelites reject this truth. You understand? Because they still are sipping the white supremacy babble, you understand, from the Bible leaders and from the white man's perspective, and they're trying to now blackwash, you understand, what white people have whitewashed, and they're confusing purposely the Queen of Sheba, trying to say that the Queen of Sheba was Pharaoh's daughter. But remember, that was chapter 3. We just went there. This is chapter 10. Now in the chapter of bankruptcy, we see here in chapter 11 something very interesting. But King Solomon loved many, it says strange woman together with the daughter of what? Pharaoh. Pharaoh's daughter wasn't a strange woman, but they were in the diva cult. They were in the goddess cult. They were in the BC feminism. This is BC feminism, people. You understand? BC feminism. Women of Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonites, and Hittites of the nations, it says, concerning which Yahweh said to the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come into you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods and goddesses. You understand? And their feminism. Solomon clave to these in love, and he had 700 wives, princes, and 300 concubines. These wives that he had were princes, you understand, from these same nations, you understand, who were all part of the BC feminism. They were all part of the goddess cults of that day and that time. And this has a lot of relevance for us in the present time, especially the black man's and the men's movement, you understand, in the church for men only, you understand, like blacktown.net and others have been preaching and proclaiming and opining on these very important issues. But we need to understand that this is nothing new. This happened before. You understand? But a remnant was preserved in the highlands of Ethiopia, of the land of Tob. Now it says that his wives, notice that, and say his concubines, but it says that his wives turned away his heart. His wives, these 700, now little silly men, silly boys who think that they are men, they look up to this and say, well, if Solomon had 700, I should do the same thing. Don't you recognize that his true wife, his real wife, was already mentioned? She already came in that sense, and one can say left, but she had that firstborn son that the queen of Sheba and only son of Menelik speaks about. You understand, who renewed the kingdom of David in the highlands of Ethiopia. And maybe now is a good time for us to get into this right here in the dictionary. But let's just go into this for a moment so you'll know exactly what we're talking about. Because it's in verse 5 of the bankruptcy chapter 11 in 1 Kings. It says here in verse 5, for Solomon went after the Ashtoreth. The Ashtoreth, the goddess. You see that right there, the diva. He went after the diva of the Zidonians and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. He went after the diva. He started to worship the goddess. He started to worship the goddesses. You understand? And here's what's very interesting. He went backward. He went backward instead of forward. The good thing that he did, it's contained in this one little chapter right here, chapter 10, is Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. She was the worthy one. And when the Queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning what? The Shem of Yahweh, she came to prove him with hard questions. You understand? And we learn the details of her conversion and the renewal of the kingdom of David in Ethiopia. But this is one reason why a lot of the pastors and preachers cannot explain when the various positive areas of scripture which mentions Ethiopia, like Psalm 68:31, Ethiopia shall stretch forth her hands to God. They cannot explain that. Or this man was born there. They cannot explain that. All they point to is where it says, the Ethiopians shall be slain by my sword. This means that Yah is righteous. Jah live, Yah is righteous. Even Solomon was someone he loved. You understand? Even David, but when they did wrong, the Almighty was righteous. You understand? So here in verse 6, it says, Solomon did evil in the sight of Yahweh and went not fully. You see that right there? He went not fully after Yahweh as David, his father. He was not full in that. But remember, David had a son named Solomon, and Solomon had a son named David, and it would be that David that would renew the kingdom of David in inner Africa, in the highlands of Ethiopia. Now, look at this right here. Verse 7, it says, then did Solomon build, it says, an high place for Chemosh, the abominations of what? Moab. Now, what's very interesting, let's bring this over for a moment. What's very interesting, let's look at this for a moment. We're in our Torah studies, right? Our Torah studies. Let's show ones the cover of this, right? Our Torah studies, right? This is the cover of it, but it's mostly in English what we call the Sabbath house, Senbet Beit table of readings, right? Now, when we get to this area right here, this is the area where this is this week's Sabbath reading is from Negadoch, called in the Hebrew Matot, or Matoth, right, as some Ashkenazi Sephardics pronounce. Now, this is the 42nd Negadoch, right, and it's Numbers chapter 30, verse 2 to Numbers chapter 32, verse 42. Now, these 10 chapters, which introduce Balak here, in Numbers chapter 22, then we have Phinehas, who had shanked that Israelite and that Midianite who were in occultic sexual worship. Just like today, we have the pole dancing and the clubs and what's happening, the demoralization, you understand, of black people, of the chosen people. Just like in Balak's time, he wanted to curse the Beit Israel. They wanted to curse the black people since the 50s and 60s. They couldn't curse them. But what they did was corrupt them. Hence, COINTELPRO program corrupted the people who could not be cursed. So we find that there is a resonance and a comparative here in these 10 chapters, or the Sabbath 40, 41, and 42, that needs to be understood in connection. Now, Balak here, he was king of Moab. So it's very important that when we look here now in 1 Kings chapter 11, Solomon's bankruptcy chapter, right? We see Solomon's bankruptcy. We see that then did Solomon build a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. And Ammon also comes in this particular sabbatical Torah reading at this particular point. They were enemies, vehement enemies of the Beit Israel, like we have these enemies today who are behind the corruption and the degeneration of the black family with the black male, the black man, particularly as a target. You know what I mean? We have a black man is homeless, black man is homeless, and the black family is manless. That the welfare signifies fear wealth to the black man's, what little of the black man's post-traumatic slavery, you understand, manhood he had, that was the little bit that they destroyed. COINTELPRO stopped the rise of the consciousness of the black messiah, stopped the rise of a black messiah. You understand? So now we have in chapter 11, this verse 8, it says, and likewise did he for all his, what, strange wives, which burned incense or incense, right, and sacrificed to their gods. Now, the Queen of Sheba is unique, is very, very unique in this sense, that she was seeking, she came concerning the name of Yahweh. She came to prove him with hard questions. You understand? And the result of that is our 3,000-year-old Solomonic, Davidic, Judeo-Christian polity or civilization that Kedemawi Haile Selassie is the point man of. And now it will become clear.